Welcome, everyone. I'm George DeStefano. I'm going to be chairing this this session, which is titled Visualized Literature in Italy. Susan is professor of Italian at College of Holy Cross, where she has taught Italian language and literature since 1998. Her first book, Figuring Women, focuses on the representation of women in the works of Giovanni Verga. More recently, she edited and contributed to a volume entitled Women at War, Sisters in Arms from the Unification to the 20th Century. Her scholarship also includes articles on Dacia Marani, Luigi Pirandello, Tomasi di Lampedusa, and Alberto Moravia, and she has contributed to pedagogical works and collected translations.
This paper is a little long, so I hope to get through it all, and once you give me a sign, I may just kind of summarize the rest. So this project was born of a paper I gave over 5 years ago on symbolism in La Lupa. In preparing the presentation, which included a visual component, I came across an illustration of Verga's short story, about which I had previously not known anything, which I'll show you in just a moment, actually. Sorry, there it is. Okay, so I came across this image of Gna Pina in La Lupa, and I was fascinated by it, and so I began exploring the topic of illustrations of Verga's work a few years later, and through my research discovered that in reality, much has already been written on the subject. My presentation today depends a great deal then on the previous work of my scholar colleagues in the field, but hopes to raise new questions about Verga and visual culture. And I'm a literary person, I'm a literature person, so this is a little bit of an expansion of what I do, and I hope to learn from all of you so that I can make this paper into an article. The increasing importance, allure, and even dominance of the visual image in today's world is not lost on anyone, especially not on parents who do daily battle with illuminated screens. Though he lived and wrote over a century ago, Giovanni Verga witnessed a similar expansion of the visual during his lifetime, the birth and evolution of a variety of visual art forms, all of which had associations with literary works. In the case of illustration, the art form on which we will focus, the artist creates images to accompany the text in an attempt to enhance its significance, or it could be argued to compose a parallel visual narrative. The question of what is lost and or gained by illustrating literary work, especially in the eyes of the author, has particular relevance in the context of verismo, and Verga's aesthetic mission to represent il semplice fatto umano, as though it appeared spontaneously on the page. At first glance, our author would seem to have an open mind with regard to visual interpretations of his work. After all, several of his novels and short stories were illustrated as well as adapted into plays and films. Yet the story of how these illustrated volumes came into being through a collaboration between author, illustrator, and publisher also reveals uneasiness on Verga's part. In this presentation, I will focus mainly on the 1897 edition of Vita dei Campi with illustrations by Arnaldo Ferraguti, and this is one of his illustrations, with the aim of illuminating Verga's murky point of view on the topic and of considering the final product, which offers rich material for analysis. During the 19th century, new visual art forms emerged in Europe, such as photography and cinematography, while the art of illustration evolved with the increased use of lithography, invented at the end of the 18th century, a process that allowed for more efficient mechanical reproduction of images. It should be noted that photography also became a tool in illustration, both directly and indirectly, as we will discuss further along. Verga's own involvement with the arts, especially theater and cinema, is widely known, yet he clearly drew inspiration from the strictly figurative arts as well. In one of his manifestos of Verismo, the letter to Salvatore Farina that serves as preface to L'Amante di Gramigna, Verga makes reference to words that are semplici e pittoresche into the work of art as palpitante di vita ed immutabile al pari di una statua di bronzo. Gianpaolo Marchi highlights the thematic and formal links between Verga's narrative works and the visual arts, noting both his inclusion of the artist figure in his novels, for example, the painter Enrico Lanti in Eva, 1873, with whom he clearly identified, and the ways in which his work inspired figurative artists like Davide Calandra, whose sculpture Tigre Reale was presumably named after Verga's 1875 novel. On the other hand, Marchi observes, compared to D'Annunzio's relationship with the visual arts, Verga's was limited and more conventional, since he did not frequent the more transgressive artistic circles like those of the Scapigliati. During Verga's lifetime, he agreed to have his work illustrated on at least a dozen occasions, though if we compare him once again to D'Annunzio, these volumes are relatively few. Marchi discusses the complicated relationship between author, illustrator, and publisher and the more significant instances, and provides a list of illustrations of Verga's works between 1883 and 1920. One of the difficulties of in determining what Verga thought about illustrations of his work is the spottiness of his published correspondence with his collaborators. In most cases, we have the letters between Verga and his publisher and those of the artist to Verga, but we are missing the author's letters to his illustrators, and thus, at times, left to infer Verga's wishes and opinions. Before turning our attention to the 1897 illustrated edition of Vita dei Campi, we will consider the example of the first illustrated volume of one of Verga's works, the Novelle Rusticane, published in 1882 by Francesco Casanova. Although it was Casanova to choose the artist Alfredo Montalti, of which this is an example of his illustrations, to illustrate the Rusticane, the artistic relationship existed primarily between the illustrator and the author. From Montalti's first letter to Verga, we know that the author had asked his illustrator to send him a few of his sketches, thereby kicking off their collaboration. From that point on, author and artist communicated directly, with Montalti promising to avvicinarmi a quel finissimo e così giusto sentimento di semplicità col quale le novelle sono scritte, to send his preliminary sketches to the author first before sending them to the publisher, and to arrange the illustrations as Verga had indicated to him. Indeed, it appears that Verga offered considerable advice both on the specified content of the illustrations and on their placement, for which Montalti was grateful, accepting submissively the notion that his art was merely ornamental, and that, quote, nessun pittore potrebbe competere con una descrizione chiara ed evidente come quella del testo. Likewise, Verga praised Montalti for requesting photographs of Sicilian life on which he could base his illustrations, commenting to Luigi Capuana, whom he mobilized to provide the photos, that the illustrator, quote, mostra così la sua intelligenza artistica e promette bene per il mio volume. This comment suggests not only Verga's seeming control over the project, but also that his interest in the illustrated volume is both artistic, and specifically verista, and practical, since he wishes for the final product to be successful, a point to which we will return. Despite Verga's participation in the production of the illustrated Rusticane, in the end, Montalti's style, which was more symbolic and akin to that of Gonin, who was the illustrator of Alessandro Manzoni, diverged from the giusto sentimento di semplicità promised at the outset. A request by the publisher to change the cover image, Casanova used the excuse that it was too political, came about almost certainly after feedback from Verga, and Montalti obliged, replacing it with a more conventional one. It is interesting to consider that, by opting for a cover image that was less characteristic of Montalti's work, which was quite trendy at the time, Verga was potentially making a choice that would be more faithful to his art, but less appealing to the public. It would also appear, however, that Verga ultimately accepted the artistic differences between himself and Montalti, his only true exasperation with the illustrator being the slowness with which he worked. Furthermore, the author's request of Capuana, who was to review the illustrated Rusticane, to, quote, trattarmi bene il Montalti and non parlare di stonatura, suggests that despite Verga's artistic concerns and participation in the creation of the volume, which did not produce the desired results, he may have also wished to save face publicly, aware that readers might shun the book should the review be negative. The author's comment to his friend leads Marchi to conclude that Verga's interest in illustrated texts was solely economical, given also his obsession with finances and openness to have his works reprinted, translated, and adapted for financial reasons. I would argue that Verga's artistic goals were clear and that they can be viewed as valid even in combination with commercial considerations. In fact, in the publishing world, it would seem difficult to separate the two sets of concerns. Ultimately, the sales of the illustrated Rusticane did not justify the sacrifices made to produce it, a reality that makes Verga hesitant to have Vita dei Campi illustrated, as expressed in an 1888 letter to Casanova. 10 years after Verga began his first artistic collaboration with Montalti, with several less documented experiences with illustration in between, the author embarks on what is arguably his most significant one, with Arnaldo Ferraguti, who illustrated the 1897 edition of Vita dei Campi, published by Fratelli Treves. This working relationship stands apart from the others for a variety of reasons. Both author and illustrator had close ties to the Treves family. In fact, Verga met Ferraguti for the first time in 1891 in Milan in the days surrounding the artist's marriage to Olga Treves, the publisher's niece. From an artistic standpoint, Ferraguti was a realist and shared Verga's artistic ideals. As we shall see, he identified with the stories of Vita dei Campi, did his own research and preparation for his drawings, and shared a pessimistic view of human progress. Ferraguti was, in his own right, a nationally recognized painter who was involved in the critical debates of his time, thanks in part to his access to Milanese social and artistic circles. So that's the cover of the edition illustrated by Ferraguti. As a consequence of both his ambition as a realist artist and his access to the literary circles of Milan, Ferraguti met Verga in 1891 and soon thereafter proposed an illustrated volume of Vita dei Campi. His letter to the author seeks to convince him to give his permission for the illustration, which the artist had already proposed to Giuseppe Treves previously, by using several different strategies. First, Ferraguti boldly declares his ambitions. So I'll let you read the quote yourself, but the important part is he wants to bring his illustrative art closer to what he's achieved in painting. So he wishes to elevate his art. Verga's short stories then would serve as a vehicle for the artist's elevation of his reputation as an illustrator. Here, Ferraguti also references his social connection to Verga, who in this period frequented the same social circles as he. So that second sentence is kind of like a wink, you know, to the fact that they know the same people, et cetera. Given Ferraguti's own commitment to Verismo, his expressed affinity for Verga's stories rings true. And here is another quote. All of these, the cursive and the exclamation points are all his, so you can see how he's really trying to make a point here. So he's basically saying that these are his stories, that Verga's stories are his, because they resonate with him. The illustrator goes on to describe his vision of the project, both its scope, 60 to 70 compositions based on the most important moments in the story, as well as his methodology, which he claims will not involve incisione in legno, but rather foto incisione, several of which will be lightly colored. In reality, the images were produced using the artist's images based on photos as well as sketches, which were then etched onto wood blocks for reproduction. The 9 colored plates were reproduced lithographically. And when I show you some of these, you'll see, in some of them you can see that Ferraguti's initials are in one corner, and then the etcher's initials are also on the illustration. The kind of preparation for the project that Ferraguti proposes in the letter echoes that of Montalti for the illustrated Rusticane, and that both involve photography, a new tool in the illustrative arts. The difference, however, is that Ferraguti wishes to visit Sicily and conduct his own research in keeping with his realist principles. A fare ciò naturalmente mi occorrerebbe di effettuare una gita in Sicilia e più particolarmente nei paesi descritti ed a lei ne domanderei l'itinerario. Actually, I have this one too. Indeed, Verga obliged, specifying the places that the artist should visit and arranging meetings with family and close friends. Stefania Stefanelli, in her insightful article on this topic, notes the desire of Ferraguti to involve the author in l'ideazione delle immagini, which occurs both within certain limits, but within certain limits, given Verga's famous reserve. The artist corresponded with the author while in Sicily, declaring his obsession with the Fico d'India, and also after the trip, asking Verga, okay, who is presumably on the island, to take photos of some interiors for him, thereby inviting him to collaborare anche lei al mio materiale artistico. The most curious part of the letter, however, states that it is known that Verga does not wish to have his works illustrated, which accounts for Ferragutti's, at times, overly obsequious approach to the author. And so these are the two quotes. He says, I hear that you don't like your works illustrated, and then he asks them again at the end of the letter if it's true. Since the author's own letters do not confirm or deny this charge, some scholars accept it as true, citing previous experiences with illustrations of his work that Verga found unsatisfactory, such as his collaboration with Montalti. Others point to Verga's own words in a letter in the letter from 1888, in which he states his wish to have the stories of Vita dei Campi illustrated, perhaps believing the material to be more conducive to a picturesque rendering of Sicilian life and to reach a wider public, especially given the previous theatrical success of Cavalleria Rusticana in La Lupa. This article by Stefania Stefanelli is really incredible because she actually does an analysis of the images. And while the reviews of this edition talk about things like, some of them are just paying lip service and saying, oh, what wonderful images, they match Verga's stories perfectly. There's not a lot of analysis. And others say that they're kind of conventional images. But what she says is, actually, she finds that he uses a lot of floral and vegetal details that suggest the Liberty style, which was popular at that time. So it's kind of the opposite of conventional. It's kind of pushing toward the future. The problem is sometimes the images really clash with the spirit of the story or with the scene. So for example, this one is La Lupa when it's the last scene of the story when supposedly Nani is going to kill her. But with all these flowers in the fields, it doesn't look that way. It just looks like she's going to visit her lover in the fields kind of thing. And there are other examples of that sort. Okay. Another point that Stefanelli makes is that these images also show, so they show what the latest artistic fad is, but they also show how photography and cinematography are becoming more important. And she notices, and someone mentioned it earlier this morning, movement, right? So this is from Miele il Pastore, as you can see, and it's Mara dancing. And this idea of movement is very clear. You almost feel like you can feel it happening. Also, the duel in Cavalleria Rusticana, she notes that this almost seems as though there were a cinepresa up above them circling. Another point she makes is that these colored plates, and this is the last point I'll make, the colored plates are placed before the title of the story. And so she calls them visual titles, and they have captions. But the problem is, so they're giving you an idea of what the story is about before you even read the title. The problem with it is they don't go together with the spirit of the story in all cases. So in this case, we have Fantasticheria, and the caption mentions the vecchietto who was rowing them in the boat, but he's not in the picture. That's her male companion. And so Stefanelli argues that this does not give you any idea of the fact that this story is about kind of the old world, the new world, or the north and the south, or high society and rustic life. And so that does not succeed. So the last thing I'll say to conclude is that this edition is remarkable not only for the illustrations, and there's a lot more to be said about them and a lot of more work to do, but it also represents the definitive, in the opinion of Giovanni Cecchetti, the definitive edition of Vita dei Campi, because Verga actually made edits to these stories for the first time, significant edits in 1897, or for the 1897 edition. And so there's a debate about whether this is the definitive volume or is it the 1880 volume. But my question would be, were Verga's edits in any way influenced by the images? Because some of these images were published previous to the edition coming out. So I would like to know, so literally, literature was changed by art, because the only reason he edited these stories after so many years was because the illustrated edition was coming out and they were changing the metal characters for a new typeface to make it bigger and to accommodate. So he was able to finally edit these stories. And so the visual has actually influenced the literary, and that's what needs to be explored a little bit more. Thank you very much.
Thanks, that was really interesting. I'm curious if there was, besides the editing process, if there's anything in the letters or something along those lines that would suggest that he's thinking about editing as a result of the images.
All of the articles that I've read, and you know, I've read some of the letters, I mean, over the years I've read many of his letters, and one of the problems with Verga research is that his correspondence really needs like a carteggio ufficiale, because there are volumes all over the place or overlaps. But everything that I've read, and this Stefanelli article was really, it was written not that long ago. Nobody seems to know anything, A, about what he thought about this illustrated edition, and B, the process that he used. But Cecchetti, who wrote this article ages ago, like in the 50s or 60s, he gives a real detailed analysis of the changes that were made and why he thinks they're superior. He thinks that it's much superior, but because it was considered a like an object of art almost, this edition, it was very expensive. It didn't sell well because it was too expensive. It was meant for a wealthy public. It was never reprinted, and scholars didn't discover it until much later, because they were busy just reading the 1880 stories, and then Cecchetti rediscovered it and said, "Hey, wait a minute, these stories are different." And so that then ensued this debate about what are the real stories, you know, what did Verga really want? But I will get to the bottom of it eventually, I think. There's a lot of backstory before you can do that, but.
Thank you very much. I really enjoyed the talk, and as someone who teaches Verga, now I think I want to include images too. I think that is a very interesting tool to use to understand the story. I was especially struck by the image of the final scene in La Lupa, because it is not at all how I would imagine it from the text. And just to pursue that last question a bit more, so he's adapting or making changes to his story based on images. Given his ambivalence towards these visual depictions, is he resisting and almost doubling down on his initial intended meaning in contrast to the image? Or is he trying to accommodate the image so that they align more closely?
I don't know for sure if he edited with the images in mind. And my guess is that, well, it's interesting. He did in a structural sense. So I'm wondering, even just because they enlarged the type and they added images, he cut a lot out of some of these stories, right? So you wonder, was it to save space? Was it, Cecchetti swears that these are more true to the verist, you know, the principi veristi. But we don't know even if he was mildly influenced by the fact that there was less space on the page, you know? I mean, it's interesting. So however, if that's true, then they did influence what he did. In terms of the content of the images, some of them were published years before, and so he saw some of them, but I don't know any specifics. I can give you another example that's similar to that of La Lupa that I couldn't get the image for the PowerPoint. But in, I'm sorry, I'm blanking. Ieli il Pastore, the scene where they consummate their relationship, which in the story is, it's not clear if it was wanted on her part, right? But if you look at the image, which is the colored image that precedes the story, it looks, there are flowers everywhere, and it looks almost like she's in ecstasy. And that one really struck me, you know, about what's going on here exactly. So like I said, there's a lot more to explore, but I think it's safe to say that at least the parameters within which he was editing were influenced by even just the structure of this edition.
Teresa Bertilotti is a historian and independent scholar who received her PhD in history and civilization at European University Institute in Florence. She currently is working on visual cultures, especially theater and cinema, and historical culture in Italy from 1860 to 1918. TERESA is also is developing a project on various forms of entertainment produced by or addressed to the Italian community in New York from the mid-19th century to the 1930s. She analyzes how national history was rewritten and reconceptualized through theater and cinema, thus providing the basis for the production of popular national histories. She's published several articles on the role entertainment played in disseminating the nation's history and on the ways in which it represented the First World War. And her presentation today is titled Narrating Giovanni Ruffini's Dr. Antonio, 1855.
The novel Dr. Antonio by patriot and exile Giovanni Ruffini was written in English and published in English in 1855 in Edinburgh, and it a nearly identical edition in Paris in the same year. The author Giovanni Ruffini was a Genovese patriot, close to Mazzini, already a member of the Giovane Italia. He was a fugitive in 1933, after he was sentenced to jail in absentia. In 1837, he arrived in England, where he learned English, and where he would later return in 1855. But he had also already spent time in Switzerland and in France. His life was marked by exile, first involuntary, and then voluntary, but also for a passion for the ideals of freedom and independence. These ideals had motivated an entire generation of young intellectuals in Italy in the early 19th century, a passion that infused Ruffini's literary works, in which the autobiographical element is constant. It is not a coincidence that when Dr. Antonio was published, Ruffini was already noted as the author of Lorenzo Benoni, or Passages in the Life of an Italian, also published in English in Edinburgh in 1833. Ruffini's work, which immediately achieved resounding success, had a political objective. Dr. Antonio, set in a small city of Liguria, Bordighera, tells the love story between Antonio, an exile from Sicily, and Lucy, a young English woman. And the novel is set against the backdrop of the political situation of the 1840s. So, written during the Risorgimento, the novel, a clear political purpose, was to draw attention to Italian national issues. And for this reason, it was both deeply rooted in the Italian context, and at the same time, it was an international literary product. After the first appearance, the editions of Dr. Antonio multiplied. Its initial success was assured by its ability to clearly transmit the motivations of the Risorgimento and to create a sympathy for Italy. It was not by chance that the American edition has the subtitle A Tale of Italy. And since the beginning of the 20th century, Dr. Antonio has maintained a discreet fame in European literature. It was translated into French and German and included in the 1861 collection of British authors by the famed editor in Lipsia, Christian Bernard von Tauschnitz. At the same time, Dr. Antonio's place in the category of popular fiction was immediately clear. The elements of the novel sustain it: tormented love between the Italian Dr. Antonio and the young Lucy, whose characters were depicted naturally but at the same time stereotyped. There was also a mix of history and invention that was made popular by Manzoni, the English language, realistic descriptions, pervasive irony, as well as romantic stylizations. So in Dr. Antonio, sentimental and political dimension coexisted. The love story intertwined with the political story of the protagonist, surviving in exile with the hope to free his country, and then condemned and incarcerated in the prison in Naples. So the figure of the exile is a central theme in the novel. Like Ruffini, Dr. Antonio is an exile in his own country. The theme of being without a homeland, of being stateless, always unstable, and searching for a sense of belonging is fundamental. Closely connected to the theme of exile is the theme of identity. The comparison between the English and Italian character, symbolized by the contrast of Antonio and his antagonist, John D'Avenna, who is going to marry Lucy, is central to the story. Ruffini is adept at highlighting the game of stereotype, which are dissembled or put to the test by common convention, and also insisted in constructing an opportune image of the Italian character. Early in the book, a kind of Italy brand is presented, focusing on a no strength, but attempting to detach the book from tradition in underlying the combination between the work of nature and the work of man, and therefore the industriousness of the Italian. And quoting for the book, the industry of man has done what it could, if not to be with, at least not to disparage nature. In this way, we immediately find ourselves confronted by a dichotomy of the image of Italy and the real microcosm, the Ligurian landscapes. Italy remains an abstract and ideal image, a utopian space subject to personification, while the Riviera is instead subject to insistent descriptions that focus on landscape elements taken as a strand, as a good, like patrimony, like grande bellezza, which immediately recalls the concept of Italy. It is also not accidental that in furnishing the reader with an iconographic reference, a work that is appropriate to the task of rendering the beauty of that landscape, Ruffini cites, together with the seascapes painted by Clarkson Frederick Stanfield, the canvases of Massimo D'Azeglio. And quoting from the book, the palette of a Stanfield or a D'Azeglio could scarcely be equal to the task. I would like to note that also in England, where he had been in 1853, D'Azeglio was the inventor of the historic landscape. He was the painter who romanticized historic landscape. He was the forger of civic and national painting with eminently patriotic and philological intentions. Linked to the theme of the identity and character is the motive of intercultural mediation. The encounter of the two cultures, two worlds, through two different identities is presented as plausible. And during the novel, there is the work of mediating distances, which nevertheless remain unresolved, first mortified by Lucy's marriage of convenience, and then, more emblematic, Antonio's choice of sacrificing love for his country. In this way, as Caterina Gephardt observed, Ruffini's cosmopolitan vision explores the possibility of an Anglo-Italian romance. However, he leaves himself suspended in a Platonic dimension, symbolically asserting the primacy of the national cause over any broader European affiliation. So the Italian version of Dr. Antonio was published in 1856. enriched by an introduction by Bartolomeo Quarone, that, pausing on fundamental themes raised by the novel, put him in a literary and political problematic perspective. Nonetheless, the following editorial changes developed a diluted and tamed, if not simplistic, reading. In this way, the novel consolidated its reputation in Italy, bent to the needs of a female public. In the decades between the 19th and the 20th century, it was reproduced by popular publishing houses like Sonzogno, Carrara, and Salani. Sonzogno inserted it in the Biblioteca Romantica Economica and approved an illustrated edition in 1892. Which was sold and distributed with great illustration by Gino De Bini. These illustrations emphasized the sentimental element of the novel. Furthermore, the novel was published in portion in 1894 in the weekly magazine Il Gioiello delle Famiglie Milanesi, that was a female weekly magazine. The years following the war signaled a change of direction. Between 1914 and 1915, two editions detracted Dr. Antonio from the pleasant literary camp for women and consecrated it in the pantheon of classics from the 19th century, despite the fact that it was a novel in the English language. Therefore, a novel in English, but that was Italian, because Ruffini was a man of the Risorgimento, whose life and feeling were deeply patriotic. The Damiano and Bideri editions, therefore, collocated the Dr. Antonio among the greatest Risorgimento novels, in virtue of its intrinsic quality and the full claim of Italianità. At that time, Italian culture was focused on constructing a national literary canon. As thought not among the greatest, Ruffini was inserted in this tradition because of his subject and the national spirit that animated his work. Even so, his novels were written in another language. In the meantime, the international reputation of Dr. Antonio was relaunched in the cinema. At the time in which Italian culture was involved in the construction of a national literary canon, cinema, as Gian Piero Brunetta wrote, translates a library in which very heterogeneous work cohabit that dedicated much space to the national hero's history. The success that the novel had could not escape the cinema. The master of silent film, who specialized in historic film, Mario Caserini, directed films centered on Roman, medieval, and Renaissance history, as well as film focused on the Risorgimento. Among his films, La Battaglia di Legnano, a great success in 1910, and in the same year, he brought Dr. Antonio to film. Unfortunately, the film is no longer visible, but based on the reviews, it was well received from the critic and from the public, and not only in Italy, as the reviews in London's The Bioscope and Madrid's Arte e Cinematografia demonstrate. In 1914, Eleuterio Rodolfi, noted for the success of Gli ultimi giorni di Pompei e I promessi sposi, directed a new version of the Dottor Antonio. As noted, the Italian cinema until the outbreak of World War I represented the cinematic arts for the international market, as the two mentions reviews attest to. So it is not possible to include the history of the novel during the years of fascism because I do not have enough time. Nevertheless, it is worth mentioning a book of on Ruffini published in 1942. The author, Leopoldini, was an authentic fascist militant intellectual who was well inserted in the regime's political and cultural organizations, and the director of the Fascist Institute of Culture in Milan from 1934 1904 to 1939. The exiled Ruffini, welcomed in England in the fascist interpretation of Pollini, became the ill-tolerated Italian in a country that in 1942 was an Italian enemy in war. The cinema of the regime also recovered Dr. Antonio. Enrico Guazzoni, celebrated author of Quo Vadis, 1913, directed a new version in 1937, when the historic film became a tool of propaganda. It's not possible to compare the different versions of films, but it's very interesting, because the film of 1910 is not visible, but there is the screenplay that is kept at the Museo del Cinema in Torino. The post-Second World War era signaled another break in the diffusion of Dr. Antonio. In the new political climate, Ruffini was immediately recovered and dusted off in a perspective that could be defined as proto-European. But once the reason for political interest in the work lost steam, as happened in the second half of the 19th century, Dr. Antonio re-entered in full force into the cultural industry of the post-war period in diverse formats. In 1948 and 1954, two radio plays were produced, and in 1954, a television series. It's not a series, it's the first Italian sceneggiato. I don't know how to translate. And it's interesting to note that the initiative coincided with the launch of a competition for amateur actors based on the model of the American stars, but following a different path, since the Italian television was under the watchful eye of the Catholic Church and the various political parties, was as it is, let's say. So between 1948 and 1968 was inaugurated the Young Reader format, sometimes in more or less abridged versions. It was adapted and included in numerous collections that multiplied in this period, and it became part of the public consciousness, especially for females. In the meantime, the novel continued to garner fame among adults in popular edition. This one is the Bosque edition, 1961. It's clear that it focuses mostly on the love story. And this one is a Fabri edition, 1961. So, in short, Dr. Antonio allows us to analyze the centrality of the visual dimension from two points of view, at least two points of view. In the novel, through the descriptions of landscapes and environments, a well-defined image of Italy is built. Secondly, entering the category of popular works, it circulated especially on the basis of images, illustrated book, cinema, and television. And it should also be remembered a further revisiting of the novel by television broadcasts, such as Miss Lucy in 1961. The broadcast was dedicated to the English colony in Bordighera and centered on places such as the famous brick house, which were the background of the events in Dr. Antonio. So it is doubtless that the novel launched tourism since 1860, especially tourism from England. And today, historians of tourism maintain that Dr. Antonio was written with this precise aim. Among the proof they cite are the pages dedicated to the economic importance of the cultivation of palms, a symbol of holidays and thus an element to emphasize for the economy of tourism in the mid-19th century. Obviously, this claim is not true, but the novel unexpectedly had that result. And once tourism became established, Dr. Antonio was used and continued to be used as a driving force for the market.
I would like to ask you if you can elaborate a little more about the current reception and readership of the book. Is the book available in English edition and Italian edition? How can you measure its popularity and circulation?
To measure the popularity is quite easy to look at reviews and also at the number of editions. As I show, in Italy there were a number of the editions since the first edition in 1856 until the 60s, beginning of the 70s.
If I heard correctly, you mentioned at one point the brand of Italy when you were discussing like the image. Can you speak a little bit more about that and how this was represented in the novel and what it meant at that time in before during the Risorgimento?
The brand as presented in the book is especially the environment, landscape. But a landscape that is depicted by an Italian exile. So I think that the way in which the novel was able to raise sympathy for Italy, for the Italian cause, together with the place in which it was the novel, the story take place. I think that it was this these two things together. Made possible to launch also the tourism. I mean to make Liguria and Bordighera in particular a so loved place to go. Because of holidays, because of palms, because of the climate, but also because it was this scenario of a love story between an Italian exile and an English young woman.
PATRIZIO CECCAGNOLI is currently an assistant professor of Italian at the University of Kansas, where he has taught since 2014. Previously, he taught Italian at the University of Massachusetts Amherst, Fordham University, and Columbia University, where he received his PhD in 2011. He is the editor of Filippo Tommaso Marinetti's previously unpublished poem, Il Poema di Fiume, as well as of the first edition of Marinetti's novel, Venezianella e Studentaccio, in collaboration with Paolo Velezio, a project for which CECCAGNOLI was nominated for the Marino Moretti Award. He has also translated two books of Milo De Angelis' poetry in collaboration with Susan Stewart, Theme of Farewell and After Poems, published together with the University of Chicago Press in 2013. For this translation, CECCAGNOLI was nominated for the American Literary Translators Association Annual Award in 2014. And his presentation today is Beyond the Futurist Words in Freedom, Marinetti's Final Poetics, and the Invention of Visual Poetry.
First of all, let me thank the organizer of this event. I'm very happy to be here. I want to thank Professor Tamburi, Professor Scholler, who are coordinating with us, and our chair, George DeStefano, and you, of course, member of the audience, for your interest in our panel on the intersection between visual culture and literature. I'm going to speak about a very mysterious object, and which is not second futurism and Italian avant-garde, which is part of my talk, in its connection with the so-called neo-avant-garde and the post-war experimental poetry of the 60s and 70s in particular. But Drawing on archival research conducted in Connecticut in 2016 and Florida in 2018 and in Italy as well, this paper explores the last poetics of the Italian futurism and the theory expressed in a very little known manifesto entitled Aeromusica dell'Alfabeto in Libertà, Aeromusic of the Alphabet in Freedom. This late and almost completely overlooked futurist work was the fruit of a collaboration between the founder of the movement, Filippo Tommaso Marinetti, Italian writer born in Egypt in 1876, and the painter Tullio Crali. Marinetti co-wrote this theoretical text during his last stay in Venice in 1943-44, where he had fled with his family, seeking refuge from the bombings that threatened their residence in Rome. Confined to his home on the Canal Grande, as a result of a declining health after the participation to World War II in the Russian front, Marinetti kept receiving visits from his fellow futurist artists. One of them, Tullio Crali, suggested a new manifesto that was to be printed on the date of the 4th of February, my birthday, 1944, much earlier, much before my birthday. Marinetti endorsed Crowley's intuitions and suggestions and accepted a collaboration also with a younger futurist artist, Raoul Chenissi, a young futurist active like Crowley in the city of Gorizia. The futurist trio produced a very rare and unknown art book that redefines the phenomenon of visual writing and its history, and this is what will be the center of my presentation today. Casting a light on this little study phase of the so-called second futurism, this paper continues the debate about the link between the first and second Italian avant-garde, starting with the work of Luigi Ballerini, Luciano Caruso, Stelio Martini, Lamberto Pignotti, among the others. And I want to remember, for instance, in 1972, on the 60th anniversary of the Technical Manifesto of Futurist Literature, Luigi Ballerini, the critic and the poet, organized in Turin, but in Italy, but also here in New York City at the Finch College, now no more existing elite all-women college in the Upper East Side, an exhibition and a conference devoted to the connection between futurism and Italian visual poetry of the after-war period. While exploring the trajectory from the first futurist typographical revolution, the subsequent development that led to the Words in Freedom poetics, quickly followed by Words in Freedom tableau, this, what the Italian called the tavole paro libere, and aeropoetry, l'aeropoesia, this paper discussed the printed version of the manifesto of the alphabet in freedom, and its type alternative unpublished text rediscovered by Amerigo Fabbri, then at the time a graduate student at Yale University, who published an edition of this text, preserved Marinetti's archive at Banneke Library in New Haven, in the journal Yale Poetry Review in 2002. On this occasion, today I will provide the first in-depth description of the visual composition that followed the manifesto, because at the time Fabbri and no other scholar knew about the existence, or at least the location, of this rare art book that I found in Miami. These graphic works show a truly prophetic vision for many future developments in the international poetic and visual practices, including sound poetry and concrete poetry. So now I'll try to, having given you a summary, an abstract of my of my paper, I would like to guide you through my visual presentation to remain faithful to the topic of our conference. I would like to say that when I notify now our totally administrative society, as Adorno would say, my travel to New York City for attending this conference, my colleagues, I didn't encounter no objection between my colleagues. They found a very reputable destination, whereas when last year I mentioned that I was going to Miami Beach to conduct research during the spring break, I noticed more than a certain skepticism, if not a smirk, in the face of my colleagues. I actually conducted research in Miami Beach in the spring break of 2018 in this great facility in South Beach, Miami, the Wolsonian, now part of the Florida International University. The Wolsonian, which has a twin institution building in Genoa, the Wolsoniana, collects more, preserves in its collection more than 180,000 objects, a collection started by Mickey Wolson, who was the son of the first Jewish mayor of Miami Beach. And it's a beautiful building in which one can find this very rare and unique artwork. You see my hand holding it in the reading room of the Wolsonian. This is the visual application of the theory expressed in this late manifesto, co-written by the painter Crowley, as I said, and the founder of Futurismo, Filippo Tommaso Marinetti. It was the same title, Aeromusica ed Alfabeto in Libertà. And this unique booklet consists of four sheets of cartoon balls glued together, carried out by the painter Crowley, following the instruction by three authors, Crowley himself, Filippo Tommaso Marinetti, and Raul Cenisi, which is, I presume, is an Italianization of his Croatian name, Cesnik. Scholars knew about the existence of a printed version of the manifesto, which, for instance, was printed in the date of 4th of February 1944, and circulated also in reprinted reproduction in, for instance, in Enrico Crispolti's catalog of an exhibition held in Turin in 1980 devoted to Italian Futurism. But as I mentioned before, Merigo Fabri found among the papers of Marinetti's archive at Banneke Library in New Haven a different version, a typescript version with autograph corrections written by Marinetti. And I don't know if you can tell that, but if you, now that I pointed to that, you can see that the printed version is found Crowley Marinetti, whereas the version in the autograph manuscript on the right is signed Marinetti and Crowley, which obviously shows that Marinetti had a different opinion about the paternity, so to speak, of this manifesto, which was suggested to him by Crowley, and that he elaborated on his own during his stay residency in Venice during the war. You might be very familiar as a New Yorker to Tullio Crowley's work because this painting, for instance, was a poster and the cover of a Futurist catalog for the retrospective which took place in 2014 at the Guggenheim Museum in the Upper East Side. And it's a painting called Before the Parachute Opens from 1939, and obviously is a clear reference to the importance of movement, but also importance of technology in airplanes to change our relationship with reality and our cognitive perspective. And Crowley archive are preserved for most part in this other institution, which I visited after I spent my time in Miami during the summer 2018, in this beautiful museum in the north of Italy, the MART, the Museum of Modern and Contemporary Art of Trento e Rovereto, designed also by the Swiss architect Mario Botta, author of the new roof. I cannot show you what I found in the way I meant, because it's not animated anymore, but you can see that there, if you pay attention, this is a manuscript version of this printed version of a work I'm going to show you in the final pictorial definitive version made by Crowley of what is called the Aeromusica of the Alphabet in Freedom. So maybe some of you who are studying Futurism, Italian avant-garde and literature are more familiar with the Poetics of Wars in Freedom, which combined poetic elements with features characteristic of prose, narrative, and freely deployed sound, especially thanks to the abundant use of onomatopoeias. It is partially because of the considerable presence of onomatopoeias that Marinetti's poetry has been considered highly mimetic. And works in freedom text deploy also unconventional use of different kind of font with the same text, mathematical symbols, and other typographic effects. And works in freedom also employed extremely simplified syntax with abrupt shift from one idea or image to another, and could utilize unorthodox and spare punctuation or no punctuation at all. This technique, which was elaborated by Marinetti starting in 1912, as theorized in the technical manifesto of Futurist literature, and then carried out in a masterpiece of Marinetti's early career, which is the so-called epic poem Zangtuntum, published in 1914, which is a reportage, war reportage of the Turkish Balkanic War of 1912, which Marinetti was following for the French journal Gil Bras, eventually developing what are called Words in Freedom Tableau, Tavole Paro Libere, which privileged graphic visual aspect of Words in Freedom over the textual, verbal, and also the performative qualities that a reading of those Words in Freedom allowed. In this futurist visual poetry, the page appears more than usual as synesthetic space in which words communicate not only through their arbitrary meaning as elements in a system of signs, but also as a visual and auditory element in shape and sound. The Words in Freedom art form reached its peak in a relatively short period of time, between 1912, as I told you, from the technical manifesto, to 1919, which is the date of Les Mots de Liberté Futuriste, a French anthology of Marinetti's early work. What I'm going to show you today is a development of this Words in Freedom, words emancipated and freed by the tradition, logocentric tradition of syntax and order. This is how appears the booklet I found in Miami, which is the unique application of the theory expressed in this later manifesto published, printed in 1944, yes, De Re Musica e Alfabeto e Libertà. The first two pages are a work written by Marinetti and illustrated by Crowley. You can see that there are four work in this page. The first two pages is entitled Siluri Umani Giapponesi, Japanese Human Torpedoes, and is written by Marinetti, illustrated by Crowley. The second one, Madrigale Veneziano, which features under the title an autograph version that says Dedicato a me Marinetti, which obviously clears a little the tradition of this text. Apparently, there used to be two versions of this booklet, and one was donated to Marinetti by Crowley, and this is the copy that one can find in Miami. Obviously must be that because of this autograph inscription by Marinetti himself. Then you have another work entitled Treno di Notte with collages, and then in yellow, the last application of the theory of the Alfabeto in Libertà, which is Lotta di Granchi by Cenisi, or Cenisi. You can see that in this visual elaboration, so to speak, the only verbal understandable component, like in a painting, it's the title that features at the top of the tableau, so to speak. And the what I'm trying to aim, and I also show you a magnified version of the manuscript version, the typed version, and the definitive second page, which features also You can, I don't know if how well you can tell, multimedia, for instance, the P in that explosion at the bottom, it's made of metal, of copper, and is glued over the page. What I'm trying to emphasize, and I want to rush to the conclusion, is that there is a full trajectory in which Marinetti, in this case, with the alphabet in freedom, renounced the use of language and used letters as mere material signs on the page, and therefore the language dissolved into images. It was meant to produce an universal international language that didn't need any dictionary or translation, and musical, therefore the title Aeromusic of Alphabet in Freedom. If the early poetics of Marinetti was acting against logocentric, traditional, linear disposition of language over the page, in this case, thanks also to the collaboration with the painter Crowley, Marinetti goes beyond the logic of sense to produce something that is close to abstract art. So my point is that rather than being a mimetic process of representation of reality, the futurist literature, once we consider, also is extreme case and elaboration that continue also during the 40s and beyond, maybe the so-called second futurism, what we can call a third futurism. Oftentimes there is a still debated chronology discussed by scholars. An early reception of futurism wanted to consider only the so-called heroic phase that ended basically during World War I with the death of Boccioni and Santelia, the major visual artist and architect of the movement in 1916, or later basically with a compromised relationship with the fascist regime. Thanks to the work of art historian Enrico Crispolti, a second futurism came out to the attention of the general audience. But still, especially from the literary side, the late futurism remained quite unknown. And if we consider the result of Marinetti's research through language, thanks also to the, as I said, the artistic collaboration with painters, something that was reproached by early fellow futurists like Palazzeschi and other members of the Florentine group of futurists around the journal La Cerba, Marinetti develops a poetics that really goes in the direction of abstract art, like futurist painter would do. Like, for instance, think about Prampolini, at the same time one of the most studied representative of this phase of the movement. If it's still dubious, the mimetic nature of early futurism, and because of the use of onomatopoeia, which after all we know is still an arbitrary production of language, and so no more mimetic than other arbitrary signs after all, it's clear now that the sounds and the letters reproduced on the page of this extreme case of futurist poetic have no clear reference to a denotatum besides the title, like in a painting itself. And so my goal is to demonstrate how relevant is this prolific late phase of Marinetti career, how relevant and influential was the collaboration with its artistic collaborators and painters in the first place, and then also to overturn, in a way, a reading of Marinetti's career and trajectory as an example of a mimetic poetics. So on the contrary, my goal is to emphasize the abstract nature of this language that defies the logic of sense. And here, for a matter of time, I stop. I wanted to guide you through images, and I conclude with this picture of Marinetti during World War II in the Russian front. And thank you very much.